He was pissed off. "Who the hell did that?" he said, pointing into the audience, outraged. Sid followed, typical of an agent provocateur, and said, "All you cowboys are a bunch of faggots." That's all they needed. Rushed the stage, brandishing knives, guns going off in the background, and the stage rained non-stop, beer cans and hamburgers. I never forget Steve Jones. As these cans kept hurtling through the air, he would nut them back like a footballer. At some point, a guy managed to get so near the stage and brandished a kind of a Bowie knife that Sid took the bass and with the bottom half of it, he smacked it down on the top of this cowboy's head.
He knew that I meant physical harm, and I have to say I was ugly about it. But he came out and hit us over the head with a bass. He was hitting us because I was going like this, "Come on, buddy," and he kept going like this. And I would have been glad to take him on or his buddy Johnny.
The Pistols' kamikaze raid was starting to take its toll as they approached the hippie capital of America.
By the time the Sex Pistols reached San Francisco, they were virtually not talking to each other.
It was like, "Come and see the circus. The circus is in town," you know what I mean?
I couldn't see any way of this continuing, and that's why it stopped when it did.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated?
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated? That wasn't directed at the audience, it was directed at us on stage. Because we had been cheated and we cheated ourselves.
As the end of the 70s approached, it seemed as if punk had failed in its attempt to gain acceptance in middle America. For the original bands in New York, it was time to change if they were to survive.
It occurred to us, well, you know, our songs are so weird. Maybe we should do a cover song on our next album. Maybe the radio will like it. Instead of just all of a sudden you got something which is making your pelvis not only go in and out but also side to side.
And that would give it that little thing that Bernie Worrell would explain to me later. You know, I would say, "Now, please explain this to me in musical notation." He'd say, "Honey, it's like when you're with your lover and you just go, you know, for that little, because you're just coming up to meet him."
And sure enough, the radio did like it, and I think it was our first top 40 single.
The Ramones went into the studio with Phil Spector, who forced them at gunpoint to add strings. But one band above all would achieve commercial success.
When I first met Blondie, they were a very dark, very strange, psychedelic surf punk band. One of the first songs they played me was Heart of Glass. And Heart of Glass, at that point, sounded like, "Once I had a love, and it was a gas, jump, jump, jump." It was a reggae song. "Soon turned out, had a heart of glass." And I said, "Well, this is a great song, but this, you know, Americans don't buy reggae. There's no way they're going to buy it in reggae form. So let's try and change it." And
And the way we presented the record was palatable to radio and consequently palatable to the American audience and the world audience.
It all seemed very far away from CBGB's.
You have to bear in mind that they just come out of the Vietnam War, and the whole situation here was very, very different. America was in a economically a much, much better position than it is now. And it's funny that now that things are beginning to crumble and fall apart and their economy is going down the toilet, that they're turning a definite eye towards punk. Now they get it. I suppose, really, it's not the music for the overprivileged.
But at the end of the 80s, long after it seemed that punk had died, something unexpected started to emerge from the American Northwest.
Radio and a lot of the media in the States finally caught on about 3 or 4 years ago with the Nirvana phenomenon. There was a small film that came out around then. It was a document of a tour of Sonic Youth and Nirvana, and it was called 1990 or something, the year punk broke. And it was an accurate title, because it's almost as if in the States, at least, more than 10 years after the fact, finally the radio stations and the media and whatnot realized that something was going on. Original groups, Clash and Sex Pistols and us and all, most of us had long since disappeared. But in a sense, we'd finally succeeded through these other groups.
Coming up next on Rock and Roll.
I think rap has helped rejuvenate rock music because it provides rock options on the vocal end of it.
Music moves from the streets to the mainstream, and the beat goes on into the 90s. Next on Rock and Roll. Funding for Rock and Roll is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Rock and Roll is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the annual financial support of viewers like you. The Experience Music Project, a celebration of creativity and innovation through American popular music and culture, opening in Seattle in 1998. The National Endowment for the Arts.
Radio Shack, with its line of popular...
In the 1970s, punks had tried to shake the rock establishment from what they saw as its apathy.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated?
But by the beginning of the 80s, mainstream rock and roll was bigger than ever, filling arenas the world over with classic rock sounds,